Ja, schönen guten Abend, meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren. Ich möchte Sie ganz herzlich begrüßen hier im Namen des Deutschen Filmmuseums. And I will switch to English for our guests here. Tomorrow the book fair will open up its doors and this year's guest of honor will be Flandern and the Netherlands. And as every year, we will accompany the book fair's program with a film program here in our museum. And of course, we will have some literature adaptations from the Netherlands and from Belgium, some new films and also some classics. And we will have also the opportunity to meet some guests here as well, filmmakers, as also some authors. But for tonight, this is a special evening and we don't have a Flemish literature adaptation tonight, but we have some. Yes, it's a special evening, as I said, and I want to give a very warm welcome to Anton Corbijn and Bart Chabot. I will not make a big introduction. I think you will introduce yourselves or each other. I will just say a few words. Anton has just been recently here in Frankfurt with his exhibition at Anita Becker's gallery and at the Atelier Frankfurt. And yes, with Anita Becker's, I think it's a long, very long friendship that combines you two. And I want to give also very warm thank you to Anita Becker's, who came up with a suggestion to do the program tonight. And yes, it was a nice cooperation. Yes. Yes, and of course, I want also to thank the embassy of the Königreich der Niederlande, who gave us the support for this evening tonight. And I want to welcome Ria Schwarz from the Consulate from Düsseldorf. Welcome to Frankfurt. And I also want to thank Jantje Bierich from the committee here from the office of the guest of honors, Flanders and Netherlands, who also helped us with the organization. And yes, now we will have the talk between Anton and Bart. And this will last about 1 hour. And afterwards, we will have the opportunity to show, to see the film, Most Wanted Man from 2014. And for this film, Anton has received also on the book fair 2 years ago, the prize for the best literature adaptation from a novel. So this is the link together also to the book fair, and I leave the stage to you two. Okay.
All right. Good evening, everybody. On behalf of me, and a warm welcome to all of you. I feel very honored to be here. When I arrived earlier today, this afternoon, I made a walk with my wife through Frankfurt, what the city center it is. And I must say, I feel very honored, but I feel even privileged to be here, because we noticed that you have a beautiful city. We have made a walk along the Main River. For you, it's of course usual stuff, but for us, it's quite new, and I've never been here before. I must say, really a beautiful city, and we decided this afternoon that we will definitely come back. That's the first thing. Yeah. Then the other thing is, ladies and gentlemen, that director Anton Corbijn asked me to read out a couple of small episodes from a biography I wrote a couple of years ago about a mutual friend of ours, the leading, biggest Dutch rock star, Herman Brood, who was also an actor, a painter, and a poet. And he was, moreover, denying that, he was also Holland's most notorious drug user. But that's quite something else. We won't get into that tonight. Nevertheless, some of you here in Germany, in Frankfurt, may have heard about Herman Brood, because he, while he was still alive, he toured with his band, The Wild Romance, extensively throughout Germany. And moreover, some of you may have heard his name, because Herman had a love affair once with German singer Nina Hagen. So that must ring a bell. Yes, it rings a bell. All right. All happy memories, I guess. So, yeah. All right. When I flew over with Anton earlier today with my wife, I suddenly noticed, I remembered that Herman had been once in his lifetime in Frankfurt. I remember that so vividly because, of course, I wrote about it, but the thing is why it was in the book, because Herman got here in Frankfurt on a Sunday in 1988, and he got arrested early in the evening by the Frankfurt police. The thing was, he was joyriding with a stolen Porsche automobile, and now the thing was, Herman didn't have a driving permit, so he couldn't really drive this car, so he started the car, and after 200 meters he nosedived with the car into a ditch alongside the Frankfurt road. And when he was trying to climb out, the police arrived on the scene and they got him out, they arrested him, and they said, well, what did you do this for, what's the motivation behind this? And Herman said, well, and that was true, that afternoon the Dutch national football team, Holland, had beaten Russia in the European Championship final 2-0. So we were, in 1988, that Sunday afternoon, we were the champions. And as you may know, that doesn't happen all too often for us. Usually we get beaten by the German team, some way or another. So, you know, we were really lucky, and that's why Herman got into this Porsche. He was arrested, he spent a couple of days in a Frankfurt prison. He came back to Holland and found out that this story had made it to the Frankfurt Allgemeine. So, you know, for about a week, you could see Herman walking around in Amsterdam with a sight on his copy of the Frankfurt Allgemeine under his arm. And if people asked, well, why we're carrying around this German newspaper, he said, well, let me read it to you. And he read out the whole story. All right. Let's get on with what I'm supposed to do here, and that's on request of Anton, of course, read those couple of episodes from the biography. The first episode is called A Domestic Scene. The Beethoven Street in Amsterdam South. Sandra, Herman's wife, opens the door. It's Monday afternoon, 12 o'clock sharp. I've just got up, Sandra says. Herman will be back in a minute. He's just out, walking Iggy, the dog. Herman's dog was named after Iggy Pop, you understand. She leads me to the kitchen. Want some tea, Bart? There is some brandy in the house, you know. On the kitchen counter is a cotton wad, a tablespoon, and a syringe. Oh, Sandra says, I see Herman has already had breakfast. That is the first part. The second part is called Sweet Massacre. I did time in Breda. Breda is a town in the southern part of Holland. I did time in Breda, Herman says, in the Dome prison, with all those circular tears. I arrived there, it was my heyday in heroin, with a bottle of methadone under my arm. They immediately confiscated it. Forced detox, an uneasy feeling. I was up on the fifth tier, somewhere up top, right under the prettiest ceiling I've ever had the pleasure of admiring close up. Every 12 hours you got a sleeping pill. It wore off after 7 hours, so then you spent 5 hours convulsing on your cot. I complained to one of the wardens. Guards, bawling, I won't make it. I put on the most pathetic face in my repertoire. I've got to have medicine. No answer. If I don't get my juice, I'll jump. Don't do it, mate, the guard said. I've seen more than my share. You'll splatter like a ripe tomato. I was cured instantly. And then, finally, on a more positive note, did I tell you, Bart, about the Love Club in Amsterdam? Soon as you walk in, you have to get undressed at the cloakroom. Then you can head for the bar, butch naked, not a stitch on. The owner and his wife walk around in knitted sweaters and in slippers. You pay and you can go nuts for 12 hours. As I was getting dressed again, the owner said to me, for one painting, Herman, you can have a whole week for free. The very next minute, I was on my bicycle, making a beeline for the studio, whipping up a painting. One little painting, Herman, and you can fuck all week. You wouldn't believe how fast I pedaled. Some guy in slippers offering me for just one painting, Herman. It's all yours for a whole week. Well, you see, then you have really accomplished something in life, haven't you? All right, that was the first anthem. Thank you very much.
I was going to introduce Bart, but he did it himself. Of course, he's a man of the word. And I'm the man of the visuals.
You're the man of visuals. Yeah. Absolutely right. Yeah.
But the reason I, not just because I like Bart, he sit next to me, but I like Bart's writing very much. And we met through Herman Brood in 1978. And we became very good friends, and we worked together. I do actually all the covers of Bart's books, and the books that he wrote on Herman, which is a few books, are by far the best music biographies ever written in Holland. So I want people to take note, and it should be translated into German or English, I think. So
no, that's all left. That's enough.
Yeah,
you did your share. Yeah.
So and. Yeah, but the other thing that happened in 78, not just meeting up and discovering that we both were friends of Herman Brood. Mm-hmm. By the way, this is not one of my pictures, but it is Herman Brood. Was that Bart played me a record that would change my life. And that was Unknown Pleasures by Joy Division. So soon after that, I moved to England, and that was 1979. I met Joy Division and photographed them, and then the singer died. And then many moons later, in 2006, I made a film about this guy. So it had an incredible effect on my life to listen to Joy Division in Bart's room.
I remember, Anton, to be sorry to interrupt you, but I remember that you usually listen to records that I played. And I remember that night that I played a band called Concert Angels and The Sound. And then you put on your coat, because you said, Bart, we had such a nice evening, and now you put on this music. It depresses me. And said, well, you have to listen to one band. This is Joy Division. And you said, no, I'm leaving now. It was such a nice, great night. Don't spoil the night. Don't spoil it. And I said, no, you have to listen to Joy Division. And I put on the needle on the first song, and that song started with The Sound of Breaking Glass. You said, oh, that's what I meant. That's what I meant. I'm out. And then you were sitting on the staircase. And the funny thing is, I think you remember, perhaps you remember this iconic photograph Anton took of Joy Division in a London tube station, where the band is standing above the elevator going down, and the three members of the band are sort of staring in the abyss to the elevator. And the only guy that looks back at Anton is Ian Curtis, the late singer, who later, of course, committed suicide.
Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, remember that. Yeah, of course. But did you remember that? Yeah, of course you remember that. But did you also remember that, you know, when I put on Joy Division, you left the room, that I called you and you heard the voice coming on of Ian, you know, and that you were standing at the stair, top of the stairs, and you heard the voice coming on, and you made exactly the same movement. So you look back to see what you had missed out on.
He's making that up, and he wants a percentage of my earnings. Picture.
I'm a very visual man.
Okay.
To get things straight, you got Natasha just mentioned it. You got an award last year here in Frankfurt.
Yes. Yeah, either last year or the year before, but I didn't collect it.
No, but why?
So I can't remember. But I think it was two years ago.
2 years ago. Two years ago. Yeah. And I think Herbert Groning might have collected it.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
We're talking.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a nice thing, Anton, getting awards, especially in Frankfurt, of course, 2 years ago. Now you come up to collect it. The thing is, Anton is a very modest guy. We've known each other for 38 years. He's a very modest guy. So I will tell this. Anton is now in Holland so much appreciated, and his work so much appreciated, that the community council of his hometown decided last year, or proposed last year, to name a bridge after Anton. Now that is quite something, you know. That's quite something.
Yeah. Tiny bridge, you know. I think it was a toss-up between a dead end street and the bridge, and they went for the bridge.
No, it's a sound bridge. It's sound. You can walk over it. It's a sound bridge, you know. Yeah. And you must tell this story to the audience. I've lived all my life in The Hague. You came later. And when you
so I'm a lot younger.
You're a lot younger. And you know, the first thing I heard about you living in The Hague is that you, when you came to The Hague to study photography at the school of photography, you first rented a room above a brothel in the street of with prostitutes, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then tell the audience this particular story about the telephone book.
Well, now it's built up as being funny. It probably isn't so funny, but and I had very little money, and it was cheap to live in the brothel. Of course, the girls only used the ground floor, and they only worked, of course, late afternoon, evening. So in the morning, the postman came to the door and gave me my phone book. In the old days, you got a printed phone book, and he said, "I also have one for the next door. Can I leave it with you?" I said, "Sure." So in the evening, I suddenly saw the phone book, and I thought, well, I'll have to give it to the girl. So I run downstairs, and my front door and their front door were next to each other. But of course, their front door was always open. mine wasn't. And they had mirrors on the windows, like you do in that profession. So I went down my stairs, got out of my door, went straight into their door, because they knew me. I paid rent. So, and then I went to the first room, knocked on the door, and somebody said yes. So, I went in, and it was a new girl who didn't know me, and she had already closed the curtain and came up to me in a very sensual way. And I was quite a shy boy, and I went like, "I just have the telephone book." So yeah, that's, and I left.
Great story, Anthony. Great story. I think so. Yeah.
Oh, that explains everything about my movies.
Okay. Well, some of it at least, yeah.
Something with stairs.
Anthony, we talk, of course, about Most Wanted Man, but let you introduce your first film. Let's take one at a time. Your first film, Control. This was based, of course, on a book, a personal memoir of Deborah Curtis, the wife of the late Ian Curtis, the singer of Joy Division. And how do you go about to make this book into a film?
Yeah, maybe I have to tell a small short story before that. I started making music videos in the early 80s because people said you should be making music videos because you do everything else for us, the album sleeve, the press pictures, and these days we need a music video, so why don't you do that too? So reluctantly I started on that, and I started to like it after a few years, and I made a few. My music videos were all had an A, from A to B kind of thing in it, so people started to tell me they like films, you know, there's a story in there, you should be making films. And I was the only one who really did not believe that I could make a film. I that was never on my horizon. I was a photographer who worked very intuitively, didn't really make much plans. It changed after I started doing music videos, my photography. I became more involved, actually, what happened in front of my camera. And so many years I was told I should be making films, especially Herbert Grönemeyer always told me that. And some people in LA started to send me scripts, and I never believed I could make a film seeing those scripts. Am I too close? God. I thought in the instructions it said, stay close to the microphone. What do I know? It's all relative, isn't it, distance? I read those scripts and never believed I was going to be the director for this particular story. I always thought there would be 1,000 guys who make a better film out of this story than this, until I was given the idea of a film about Ian Curtis based on that book. And then I thought, well, if I ever make a film, maybe this is the moment, because I'm emotionally involved in the story. It's also my story. I came to London, photographed them, got to meet them, did more pictures with them. And after Ian Curtis died, my picture became very well known. So it's kind of also my story. So that's the film I set out to make. The producers were hopeless, and it turned out to be we had no money 3 weeks before we started shooting. So in the end, I made it all with my money. But then I discovered during the make of the film that they had promised final cut to the widow.
To the widow, to Deborah Curtis.
Yeah. And that is a really dangerous part, of course, because it's my money and somebody else can tell me if the film is gonna be good or not. And on top of that, I, of course, thought the book was very one-sided. So I wanted to tell the real story of Ian Curtis. I didn't want to tell Debbie's story, but Ian's story.
Yeah.
So that he had a girlfriend in the film, that's Alexander Maria Lara, who married in the end Sam Riley, the guy who plays Ian Curtis. So it was a nice set in that sense. I also wanted to have her angle, and I wanted, you know, Ian really loved that woman, Alexander Maria Lara, the character, called Annick Honoré. So that's how we made the script. I didn't write it, but then I got I was part of it, and I talked to Annick and I talked to Debbie during the filming. I had to have this conversation with Deborah Curtis, saying, "Well, listen, you really have to give me the rights for the final cut. You cannot have these rights. I've paid you for the book rights. You have to see the script. This is the film I'm making, and you just have to believe that. But I can't take that risk." So she was on a lot of pressure, and she agreed. And she came to the premiere, and I showed her the film prior to the premiere. But in the end, I think she was really unhappy with it because because she wanted to be a character that was more important in the film, and didn't want the film to show the love of Ian for his girlfriend.
Yeah.
You know, but this was the real story. I wasn't telling her story, so that was complex, and I learned that. You should not get the writer of the book really involved in that sense, if it's an emotional thing.
Yeah.
Sorry, I think the microphone keeps coming closer.
Yeah, it creeps up on you. It creeps up on you, yeah.
Something, yeah.
Yeah.
So, and then that film, you know, I, like I said, it was my own money, but I had no agent and the contracts were all terrible. So
am I correct that I remember that you even had to mortgage your own house again?
Well, that was the only way to get the money, but I had to sell the house in the end because.
So you sold this house to finish the movie?
No, after the movie was finished, because I realized then that I didn't get the money back. But it's fine. It's not a sad story. No. You know,
it's quite a way to start.
Starting to make a fifth film, so it was a great investment. It was a great experience and adventure. Yeah. Yeah. And the movie was so well received that I never anticipated that, because I didn't know the film world, so I didn't know what kind of expectations you could have.
I remember you told me that you thought that at the time that you made this film, made Control, that you thought it was going to be your one and only film.
Yeah, I always thought, well, if I make a film, that's probably be this film, and that's why I put my money into it, you know. And I felt that I want to make a film in my life, and because of the reaction, and also I was very intrigued by the process, and although it was very stressful, I have incredible memories of making that film. You know, when I think of that summer in Nottingham, the movie plays in Manchester, but we couldn't film there, so we shot in Nottingham. It's so ingrained with the film, the sense of being in that place for 4 or 5 months.
Yeah.
And that's wonderful, and it was a great crew, and the actors were fantastic. So it was fantastic, and because of the reactions, I got so many things offered. Usually, movies about diseased musicians, I have to say, I got offered Kurt Cobain, Jeff Buckley, Marvin Gaye, you name it, any musician who died.
You died, you get a film.
I was going to be the guy to make that film. And I thought, well, if I...
Busy days.
If I do that, they keep falling like flies.
Yeah.
But I could have made a career out of it, but I felt if I do this, then I'm forever going to be a rock photographer and rock. And so I thought, well... Yeah. If I now have made a film that's successful, but that has an incredible emotional input for me for the story, let's see if I can make a film without that emotion. You know, just to see if I can make a film. So I told myself I do 3 films in total, and then I decide. So the second film, I try to do something diagonally across from Control. So Control is black and white. Next film is going to be color.
We talk about the American.
We talk about the American. Yeah. And I worked with Control all with English actors, and I wanted to work with American actors just to see the difference. It was fictional, you know, the American.
It was based on a novel, of course.
It was based on a novel, which was fictional itself. But the other thing is, it was a very different genre. Instead of a biopic, it was I wanted to be a sort of Western.
Western, know? Right.
And so it was an English novel by Martin Booth called A Very Private Gentleman. That already sounds very English.
Yeah.
But because I wanted to work with an American actor, and that became George Clooney, I felt it had to be a different title.
Right.
So, and I wanted to make a Western really badly, but I couldn't find a good story. So I made this film, the structure of this film, I made into a Western.
Yeah.
Where the Western, you know, there's a shootout in a place. The guy leaves, escapes, hides somewhere in another town. He befriends the prostitute and the priest, as you do. Yeah. but then the past catches on up with him, and there's another shootout, and he has to leave town again. That's in very simple words, that is the structure of the film. It's not unlike a Western. And there's even a cafe scene where he watches a Sergio Leone movie.
Yeah.
And I actually had gone to meet Ennio Morricone, who did the music for Sergio Leone, to see if he could make
a score for,
us, because we were filming in Italy. And it was lovely at Ennio Morricone's place, and he played me some piano music that he thought was good. But basically, he had a drawer with some unused
stuff.
Soundtrack, and that's what he wanted to give to me. And he said, "My son will finish it for you." And I didn't feel I got the attention that maybe the movie warranted. So I asked then Herbert Grönemeyer to do it. But what I wanted to say is that because I wanted it so badly to be a Western, I called it Il Americano, which is imperfect Italian for the American. Because I wanted George Clooney's character to look like he wanted to assimilate, but he couldn't do it.
That's
why it was wrong. But
Il Americano, you say? Yeah. But that is wrong English anyway, isn't it?
That's why. Because he couldn't assimilate, so even the title was incorrect.
Because it should have been...
El Americano.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, but it was a studio film. That was the other thing, of course. Control was independent.
Yeah.
And it was a studio film. So, you know, I had to work with very different forces, and it was difficult.
But difficult, to say the least, because I remember that you told me that, you know, you had driven around Italy searching for locations, and you found a really beautiful village that was ideal for filming, for using, and that, well, you better tell the audience yourself what happened to that village.
Yeah. So I come down the staircase to the block, under the other story.
No, tell them both.
No, it's just the place we found was called L'Aquila. And so I went to the script writer to drive around. The L'Aquila was going to be our main town.
Yeah.
He was writing the script. And, you know, we sent it to George Clooney. And George liked it. He wanted to meet me. He was filming Up in the Air in St. Louis in Missouri. I went there and arrived April 8th in the evening. I was going to meet him the evening of April 9th.
Yeah.
I wake up April 9th, switch on the TV, and what do I see? L'Aquila in ruins, because there was an earthquake.
Yeah.
I thought, oh, this movie is gone. You know, I'm meeting George Clooney,
it's all off.
For no purpose. But George just went like, well, we find another town. which of course we did, you know. And that's me being so new to filmmaking. I was like, oh, this is... The town is gone.
Yeah. Small problem. Okay. Well, you learned something else from making the American, and that's what you told me last Saturday when we talked this over. You learned something about marketing a film.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we prepared this talk, as you can tell. And one of us wrote it down. It wasn't
me. I wrote it down. Yeah.
The American, was like I said, a studio film from Focus, that was part of Universal, and they made this trailer that made it look like an action thriller, you know, and in fact it was a very non-action kind of film.
Hardly any action at all.
No. So, but that's not what they were trying to sell. So they made an action film thriller. I had no say over it. I made comments and then they moved one frame or something. You know, there was no change at all every time I made comments. So that was it. Then it came out in Labor Day weekend in America, and it went to number one for the first week. It came out to number one. So that was in itself great. But what happened is, of course, the audience that went there hated the film because they thought it was going to be an action film. The people who might have liked the film didn't want to go see that.
Yeah.
So it slumped, and then I got better views because the people thought it was actually film. And it was only later when the DVD came out and came on TV, it really gained an audience, you know. Yeah. And now I actually hear only good things about the American, but maybe I don't speak to the people who don't like it, but it actually really did get a big audience. I remember Patti Smith telling me that she has watched it 5 times, and she met George Clooney at some event at the White House, and the two of them happened to stay in a room, was in a room together waiting for a car or something. Yeah. And she said, I really like the American. And George said, oh, really? I think it's a little, what word did he use again?
Yeah.
Obscure.
And that's a rather unusual
said,
word.
Yeah, Patti said, well, not to me. I watched it 5 times. So,
Are you implying, Anthony, that George Clooney wasn't from the beginning really convinced when he saw the movie for the first time?
Yeah, I think what happened was that you know, George is a great guy, and he was also produced on the film, and he was fantastic. But he, I think, he likes best when his character is more like George Clooney, and right. the character. Well, no, I'm not mean or funny. He's very good at being George Clooney, but the character, of course, was quite dark, and I don't. In a way, I think he's uncomfortable with that. You know, although he likes to. I mean, he read the script and he wants to do it, but I think he was maybe a little uncomfortable with that. But I saw him earlier this year, and you know, he couldn't have been nicer. You know?
Yeah. No grudges.
No grudges. They were left home.
Yeah. The novel it was based on, Very Private Gentleman. The writer was, of course, had died before you made it into a movie.
Yeah, that made it easier. I didn't have these. I didn't have these conversations.
Yeah. In what way? Of course, you have to deal then with the widow of the writer, I suppose, or the children of, or
no.
Or the publishing. I think
you know, the rights were bought of the book by 2 English ladies a long time ago, and we got those rights. So yeah. These ladies came now and then to the set because they had to be made executive producers, of course. Yeah. So you know, they sometimes had an opinion, but that was
So that didn't bother you?
No.
So you could do with the book whatever you liked?
Yeah.
As a matter of fact.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then we move on to the film that we're going to see tonight, Anton, with your permission.
Yeah.
Or would you like to say something about Control or the American? Add something to it?
No, I think we're covering a lot of ground here.
Well, but the funny thing is, talking about it, of course, the Most Wanted Man is again based on a novel. Written by John le Carré, also called The Most Wanted Man. And it's not your words, they are my words, but I think you won't contradict me if I say I read the book and I wasn't really convinced that it was a really outstanding novel.
No, I think John le Carré...
He wrote better once.
He wrote better once, exactly. I was just going to say that. But what interested me in the book was that it dealt with our times.
Yeah.
You know, it's the post 9/11 period.
Okay, yeah.
And I felt that if I make another film, I wanted to make a film that resonated with me in terms of subject and you know, the changing of the world. And of course, the book was written in 2008. I made the film in 2012, and the world was already far more polarized than in 2008. And now it's gone crazy, of course. So, you know, that the film was, you know, sort of, underlining that danger of polarization, and that's why I wanted to make that film.
The producers of that film were the sons of John le Carré, if I'm correctly.
Yeah,
is that right? Or was it somebody else?
No, there were also there was an English producer, Gail Egan, who had done also the Constant Gardener.
Okay,
and she's a great producer. Yeah. Constant Gardener won I think an Oscar. And I mean, the great thing with the sons of John le Carré being the producers, was that there was immediate direct access to John le Carré as well. So I had meetings with him. He came to the set. You could ask him anything he wanted. Yeah. The downside of it was that I guess it was the first time they produced, and I think they were also protecting their father's legacy. So
yeah,
you know, it had. You know, advantages and also some disadvantages.
Yeah.
And
It would have been easier if John Le Carré had died, of course.
Huh? Yeah, but thank God not, because he's an incredible, colorful man, and I hope he will write a lot more books. But so that was that, and of course, you know, Philip Seymour Hoffman, who played his first European role ever, was going through a very difficult time. So it was not such an easy film to make. And I had to work in Germany, which is also difficult.
But only joking. Just to be on the safe side, only joking. You got to be careful about this, and you got to be careful. Yeah.
No, but that I really enjoyed. I was in Hamburg for 6 months or something, and what was so nice about it, that Hamburg is not featured in many international films. No. So basically, the international audience watches, you know, a canvas that they don't know. And that was wonderful. I mean, if you shoot in Berlin or Paris, everybody immediately recognizes where you are.
Yeah.
So that wasn't the case in Hamburg, which I liked a lot. And
Could you imagine a film being shot in Frankfurt? By you?
I don't know. It doesn't start for me that way, but maybe, you know, if it's set in Frankfurt, I could film it.
Okay.
I mean, we did 1 day or 2 days in Berlin, but it was all Hamburg for the rest.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm learning. You know, I don't know much about filmmaking, so this was my third film, and but every film you learn something, you experience, and I'm lucky that I work with really great actors.
What did you learn from Most Wanted Men while making it?
I guess you learn basically about script making and how things change, because Philip was very, you know, somebody who writes at night to you that maybe tomorrow we should do this or that, we should make the story maybe more this or like that, and you know, all these possibilities, of course, are killing you when you make a film, but it's really great.
So you received when you were in bed, so to speak, after midnight, you received emails written by Philip Seymour Hoffman about tomorrow, the day after, the next day, about sort of changing the thing you plan to do.
Yeah, I mean, that's very usual. That's not uncommon, you know.
George Clooney as well, you want to say?
With George, yeah. I mean, there's filmmaking, it changes. It's not a static process. It's a process of change, because once you make things and you see how it flows, then you think, oh, maybe that scene there should be, you know. And for me, it basically, you know, I'm steering the ship somewhere, but it veers a bit off course now and then, but you want it to end somewhere, that's what I have to keep in mind.
Yeah.
But if it's a good suggestion, then I'll take it. And Philip,
so you followed up on a couple of suggestions.
Absolutely, I can't think of any now, but I do.
You said to me last Saturday that you changed the novel a bit in this, but there was a new opening to it. Thought of a new opening of the film, but it's not in the book, and a new ending.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, I think that's the no. I think any director would. You always change things, so you want to. You make things yours. I mean, with both with The American and with A Most Wanted Man, I was there right from the beginning, from before the script was written. Mm-hmm. So you can already have a lot of input there. You know, I can't write. I don't have the patience to write, but I can change things and I can tell people I'd like it to go this way. So I remember. When The American was just about to come out in August 2010, I guess, I was with a scriptwriter who was an Australian guy, Andrew something. I went to Hamburg because I wanted Hamburg and I wanted to find the right buildings, the architecture, you know, so he could work that into the script, these things. Yeah. And me being Dutch, you know, we arrived to the station from the airport. I said, well, let's rent a bike. So the two of us went to Hamburg on a bike, but the poor guy, he'd ridden many horses in Australia, but he wasn't really familiar with bike. And at end of the day, he was standing on his bike. He couldn't sit anymore. So he had a very painful plane ride back to Australia.
And there's a perhaps a more personal thing, but you know, I saw the film when in Berlin, as a matter of fact, in I think 2013, no, 2012, could have been 2013. Yeah, 13. And of course, I saw the film with your English producer, I think, with about six people, and was tremendously impressed by the film. And at that point, of course, Philip Seymour Hoffman was still alive. So the film worked without knowing all that came later, of course. But while filming, while shooting the film, while working with Philip Seymour Hoffman, did you at any moment, you know, any particular moment in time, have a feeling, an uneasiness that something might be wrong with him?
No, I, you know...
that he had severe problems, or that was something was bugging him.
Philip was a man who was so great in his art that he was struggling with it. He told me once that he hated the thing he loved.
You mean acting?
Yeah, because he was tremendous, and I think he wanted to get high, but he put the bar already so high, so I don't know what he was fighting against, you know. And he was never happy, you know. He was struggling with it, and he had moments that he shouted at me, you know, you make me do all these shit things, and then you look at what we actually did, and it's fantastic. You know?
Yeah.
So there was a fight with him that he was never good enough. And he was an intense man, so I did think he was maybe using something, but I didn't think it was going to be heroin. You know, he looked disheveled, but I wanted that character to look like that. Yeah. So I thought, you know, he's getting into that role. I loved him very much, I have to say. That was sad. I mean, we spent time in Sundance.
Sundance in January.
Together, yeah. January, February.
2014, January.
So we were a whole weekend there, and we had dinners, and, you know, I drove with him in the car where I was making phone calls to the kids. And, you know, he was very much alive in terms of, you know, what he wanted to do, and he was... It was just a weekend because he was filming Games of Thrones or something.
Hunger Games.
In Atlanta. So we had. You can tell I don't watch these things.
No.
He looked a little rough, but he was not drinking any alcohol, and I felt that was great. And exactly 2 weeks to that day, he died. You know, so that was a shock, and I was very happy that I had finished the film. Because. The ending was also not scripted. It was an ending that I thought of at the moment. You know, we got into at the end. You know, he walks to the car and sits in the car.
Be careful, because they've got to watch it. You know.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So anyway, the ending was not scripted, but I loved what I did. The ending. It was after his death. It was a difficult ending to watch.
Yeah.
But I left it like that. You know, because we had. Finished that film with him, and he was very happy with it. So, of course, I forgot.
The ending. They know now. It's not a happy ending, but you know, that's about as far as we can get. Of course, you told me that Philip Seymour brought a lot to this particular role of Günther Bachmann. That he really was like that character. That didn't really have to do so much. That he already was.
Philip, I think he was always the character he played. You know, whether it was like one of my favorite Philip Seymour Hoffman films is Charlie Wilson's War and Along Came Polly. Yeah. I mean, there's of course Capote is also fantastic. There's many. I mean, he's never bad in a film, never ever. But you know, he can play comedy very well, and he was then great. You know, so whatever you needed for the role, you know. Also, Boogie Nights. You know, which actor wants to look like that?
Not many.
So there was no vanity apart from whatever was good for the role. He would go for that.
Yeah,
and that's rare because actors have always a vanity. You know?
So
I don't think you can find a better actor of that generation. Mm. Definitely not.
Yeah,
Is it time?
Is it time?
Oh, okay. No?
Okay. Okay, well...
That's the first thing you like something I said?
Yeah, well, we got to watch time, I think. But, all right, let's move on then to... what did John le Carré think of the movie?
I think John le Carré likes more... movies that are more stylized, that have a darkness to it. This movie had emotion in it for me, and I think that's maybe he maybe looks at it different, but anyway, it didn't matter, you know. It was a film that was very successful in terms of reviews.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
I'm very proud of the film, and so was Philip. You know.
Yeah, and let's move on then to your fourth. Film.
It's hard for authors to see that film to see that book on screen.
Yeah. Well, you could say, you know, that usually they say, well, the book was better than the film, but in this case, in the Most of Man case, you could say that the film is better than the book. You're not going to disagree with it.
I'm very happy with the film, but I didn't write the book.
So. Your fourth film, the last film you made so far, because you work on a film for next year, is the film Life, about a specific period in the life of James Dean and a photographer. That was not based on a novel. What was it based on?
My life. No, it's
That is about it.
No, the reason I did the film was because it was based on a photographer who spent 2 weeks with James Dean, and you know, a lot of my life I've spent photographing also people who are in the public eye, so I sort of connected to that. It was not a film about James Dean per se, you know. It was the character in it, and it was not based on a book, but it was based on the photograph that photographer had taken.
Right.
So you knew these were real events, or had been real moments.
Yeah.
And we used to try to connect the dots, and we made a story that would follow.
Okay. So you had, from starters, you had the photographs by the photographer.
Yeah.
Those images.
Yeah, it was Dennis Stock. He was a great photographer from Magnum magazine. And he was the photographer who took that famous picture of James Dean on Times Square.
Times Square, in the rain.
Yeah, exactly.
Smoking a cigarette,
yeah. And also was the only photographer ever went to the farm where James Dean grew up and took pictures of that. So we have a beautiful set of images that show you a little bit where he grew up with his aunt and his uncle. Yeah. And so we made a story up there. But of course they liked each other a lot.
Yeah.
James Dean asked him for his next film to be on set as a sort of, he gave him a sort of name so he could be on the set. You know.
Yeah.
Function. So obviously, you know, there was a friendship between these two guys.
Yeah.
So we knew there was a friendship, and we knew these moments that exist. So we just created something. How two characters can influence each other.
Yeah. All right. So you could make a story out of the fact that when you put the photographs, almost at the map where they had been together.
Yeah.
And you could go from one place to the other, so to speak.
Yeah,
and making a development in the friendship and the things where they went.
Yeah, no, it's indeed, that's how we did it. Started in LA and then went to New York and then went to the countryside. I forgot briefly where it was, but the countryside.
Yeah, it's a rather unusual way to start with making a film.
Yes, but it, you know, I'm sure that the films about Marilyn Monroe or any of these, there's real events that have happened, and the rest you have to fill in, and that's.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I guess it's the freedom of the writer. You know?
Yeah, yeah. I remember that you started filming Life immediately after you had finished A Most Wanted Man.
Yeah, it came together very quickly, and it was a very low budget film. And we had to film in Toronto because Canada is cheaper to film than America. But unfortunately, it was midwinter, and it was sometimes minus 28 degrees outside. And it's very hard to make films that way. Yeah. And we had 28 days to shoot, so it was little, but. Yeah. We had really great actors, and that was a great joy.
Let's say Most Wanted Men got rave reviews all over the world. Perhaps could have been one outsider who didn't like the film, but you know, basically everybody liked the film, and rightly so. You could say that Life was met with more mixed reviews in a way.
Yeah, possibly. I mean, in Germany and France, it got really good reviews, actually. But in some countries, it was not even released. Yeah.
No.
Yeah. But that's fine. You make a film, and you can't have these expectations. You just make a film because you want to make a film. You can't make a film because you think there'll be a massive audience for it.
No.
I mean, you hope that maybe, but you can't be the reason.
Yeah, right. So you're still totally happy with the film. You wouldn't want to change a bit if you could redo it again, or would you perhaps work again on the script if you could do it all over again?
Perhaps, because it came together very quickly. You know, if I look back at my films, I think Most Wanted Man is probably the one I'm happiest with.
You know? Yeah. I wanted to ask you if you had to make a choice. Of course, that's a killer question because you have to kill your darlings. Just having said about control, the way it went, first being the first and only film, probably, you know, but you thought at the time, it's difficult to pick your favorite film. But Most of them is your favorite film of the four of them.
I think so, because it was the most complex one to make for me. Yeah. So it was satisfying in that sense. Yeah. And just to work with Philip, you know, that was just... really tremendous.
Yeah, yeah. So back again to life. So if you could do it all over again, apart from having a low budget and apart of having not much time to shoot a film, would you change things in the script, the original script?
Perhaps. I would have used some different music, you know, because but there was no budget for music, so that was a problem, for me at least, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's some scenes we had to leave out, but in the end, you know, you forget these things when you look at the film. But I haven't seen it for a while, so I don't know if there's a specific thing you're thinking of.
Well, I remember that you when the film was released some time ago, we talked about it, and you said to me, well, it happened in a hurry. I had to do it right, after Most Wanted Man. I wasn't able to prepare myself properly, not like in the way I used to do that. And perhaps if I could do it all over again, I think I would change the script. I would have been helped by a better script. That's what you said to me about 1.5 years ago. That's a long time ago.
probably that's the weakest point.
Because we have to talk about script. What would you change about the script life if you could do it now again all over? Would you change the ending of the film, for example?
No, actually, I like the ending.
Would you like to change the beginning then? Or just the whole middle part?
No, I think maybe the beginning, yeah. But I think I probably wanted to have a more dynamic between the two than I actually had. You
know? Yeah.
Maybe that.
Yeah.
Let's end on some positive stuff.
Yeah, well, we're going to. Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, Anton, four films in, starting perhaps next year on your fifth film. What did you learn about script writing, about changing a book into adopting it into a film? What did you learn? What were the basic things that you learned? What have you taken from it, doing all this?
Coming back to what you said about life, I think that you know that it's the start of anything is the script. So if you're not happy with the script, you know, you shouldn't start making the film.
Right.
I mean, that's the basis. You can't just say, well, I have a good actor. It has to be totally how you see it, because it's the basis of everything you make.
Yeah.
So that, you know, that's the main thing I've learned, I think, that you know, that has to be
the foundation. The script is the foundation of the film, so to speak.
Yeah.
And the foundation has to be firm, solid as a rock.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're in trouble. Watch out.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if it's as solid as a rock, the script, then you can allow yourself to be influenced by some people, for example, like the actors, George Clooney, saying, well, we could change that, or we could go in another direction.
That happens all the time.
Yeah.
You do that. I mean, the Coen brothers, I think, are incredible script writers. They they film exactly as per script, per line. You know, nobody's allowed to change a line. I'm not so visionary, so with me, things change now and then.
Yeah. Is it, you know, Anton, wouldn't it be nice for you, is it an ambition for you? Making films out of other people's novels or other people's memoirs or whatever. Can you foresee in the foreseeable future that you would write a scenario or a script yourself and make it into a film?
Well, I definitely would like to be more and more involved in filmmaking, because I think, you know, I come from a sort of craft where you're mostly the master of what you make. You know, you have control over what you're making. And in film, that's very difficult to keep that full control. So the more you can be part of that film, making, in script writing, producing, and directing, the more you you're probably going to be satisfied with what you're making.
Yeah.
Because it's more yours, you know.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah. You know, sounds like a good ending.
Yeah, this is a very good ending. Yeah. Great. I think that I would love to hear a bit more of your Herman Brood.
Yeah, well, I promise to do
English.
That. Yeah. The translation, yeah. Translation. Well, two short parts, and then I'll read out two short parts of the Herman Brood biography, a special request of Anton, and then afterwards, after that, we will have a Q&A, so you can ask Anton the questions, and he will answer them. Which is quite something, and then there will be a short signing if you have any books, and Anton is happy to sign them, and then shortly after that, a Most Wanted Man will start, and you are in for a treat. Even if you've seen the film once before, I've seen it a couple of times now, still it's your masterpiece. It's really in for a treat. So I'll read this the two things about Herman, then the Q&A, and then the signing, and then the Most Wanted Man.
It sounds like a good script.
Okay. This is a small episode from the theater tour that Herman and I undertook 1 year before his death, or in Herman's case, I should say 1 year prior to Herman's suicide. Herman is enjoying his own private joke on stage. I had a girl once, Bart. I spent 3 days in bed with her without realizing she had OD'd the very first day. I got taken to court on charges of necrophilia. How do you plead? The judge asked. I said, Your Honor, I thought she was asleep. Which reminds me, says Herman, guy goes to the doctor. He says, Doctor, I think my wife is dead. Really? Asks the doctor. What made you think that? Well, the guy says, the sex is the same, but the dishes are piling up. And then... 1 year later, of course, Herman committed suicide by jumping off the roof of the Hilton Hotel in Amsterdam. And when Herman jumped off the roof of the Hilton Hotel, he did not so much jump to his death as to the fulfillment of his myth. Herman knew that with his jump, he would, like Vincent van Gogh and his heir, become a legend and thus timeless. Still, you've got to be careful with gags like that, as this poem shows is called Exit Strategy. Exactly. 5 years after the death of Herman Brood, I mean 5 years to the day after Herman's self-stage grand finale, I walk onto the parking lot in front of the Hilton on the Apollo Lane in Amsterdam. First I look up at the roof from where he made his legendary jump, and then at the place where his body, after a rough landing, lay for hours. And sure enough, on the facade of the hotel, a panel shimmered in the late Tuesday afternoon light, a plaque. I went closer until I was right in front of it, face to face with the brass plate, the well-earned memorial, and I read the inscription, "Please do not park bicycles here." Which goes to show, don't jump off high buildings before thinking twice. Right, then, thank you very much. Then it's time for the Q&A. This is the moment that you can ask Anton the question you've dreamed of asking him for a long time. You are a regular visitor of Frankfurt, but not every day. So this is the moment to... well, you're not shy, are you? I mean.
No, but I think we were very clear. I was very clear in everything I told people. I can't imagine there be a question.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Ria's asking if I can tell her something about the next film. Well, the next film is a little difficult to get together, but schedules of actors, budget, and everything. But it's a film based on a book that won a Pulitzer Prize. It's called Devil in the Grove. The Grove being Orange Groves, and it plays in the late 40s in Florida. And it centers on a case where a white girl, 17-year-old white girl, accuses four black kids of raping her. Now, that actually never took place, that rape. But in those days and that place, the South of America, a white girl accusing black kids of doing something, her word would be law, basically, would be the truth. So it's about that court case. Which, of course, it's a long story, but there's a court case and there's a retrial. And of course, they're sentenced to death. But in the retrial, the lawyer who gets involved is Thurgood Marshall. And Thurgood Marshall is a great figure in the African-American history. He later became the first black Supreme Court judge. So he knew more about law than anybody in the room. But even he could not change the death penalty, because it was just impossible. The jury would always be white, and there was no way they were going to give a black guy his rights. So it's that story, you know. And it's so relevant to what you see happening in America at the moment, and that's why I feel very compelled to make this film.
Anybody else? There, over there, gentleman over there, yeah. If you speak out loud, then can we hear you without a microphone even?
Well, yeah.
Oh, there's a microphone there.
Okay, thanks very much. I was born and raised a few kilometers away from the village you choose in Italy for shooting The American.
Oh, really? Which village is that?
No, I was born in Pescara, but my family is also based in L'Aquila.
Okay. So I went to eat once in Pescara.
Okay. Yeah. Nice to hear that.
Yeah,
and so,
it's very good fish.
Just thanks. I just wondering why did you choose my region for shooting the movie?
Well, you know, it was based on a book, and the book was set in Abruzzo. So we found nice villages. I think one village was maybe mentioned in the book, but they were quite vague about it. But that's why we went. And I love that area. It's not very touristy. And the Campo Imperatore is a beautiful sort of flat land, very high up in the mountains with wild horses, and I loved the villages, and because of the earthquake the villages loved us, because they were very happy that somebody made a film there and spent some money. They really needed money desperately, and it was super nice, you know. But like with Control, I had memories of Nottingham, but this, I have such great memories of Abruzzo. And if I have wine anywhere, I always order Montepulciano d'Abruzzo these days. Yeah.
Anyone else? Yeah, oh, you over there, yeah.
In your first movie, Control, you can really, if to anyone familiar with your work in photography, you can see a lot of your style in Control. And not a lot in your later movies. Was this part of your conscious decision to leave the rock star photographer behind as regards filming?
Well, leave the photographer behind, yeah. I think that it's very easy in films to have style over content. And you see a lot of people who make very stylized films. And I feel that I want my films to look good, but less obviously so. You know, so for me, Most Wanted Man looks really great for me, but it's less easily understood how good it looks. I think you have to maybe understand more of it to see how good it looks. And I prefer that, you know. I prefer that people see more than just the images. So it's difficult sometimes to make those decisions to go for not for the easy shot, but I think you get deeper into the film if you go more for what's in the film than the surface of it.
This may be a really stupid question, but I googled it and didn't find anything on it. In Control, you have the light changes, and Ian Curtis was epileptic, and that was the main reason or important reason why he killed himself. And the changes did remind me of something that could trigger, that I have read could trigger epileptic seizures. Is that just my impression?
Wait, sorry, if it changes?
Because the light keeps coming and going.
Oh, yeah, flicker, yeah, of course, that's why, on stage, that's why he had epileptic fits. And I've actually been to a concert where he had a fit, you know, I've seen it.
Yeah.
It's terrifying. Yeah, no, of course. I mean, his whole condition was worsening, but then also his private life, because of his mental state, his private life looked a lot worse to him than it actually was, you know. But, you know, I can't speak for him. Maybe, you know, his mind was just a certain way that you see in the lyrics. He liked the darkness, you know, he was attracted to that, unfortunately, yeah.
Oh, damn, yeah.
Just a technical one. You said that the core for your filmmaking is to have a very good script that you are good with. Is that also your approach, or was that your approach when you did video clips?
Well, I have to say yes, because the video clips I did write myself. You know, it's small potatoes video clips, because you have a great song, you can basically put any kind of visuals under it, you know, and you get away with murder. I see that now that I make films, how easy video clips are to make. Yeah, a good idea, also in photography, a good idea, you know, it's the basis for things, yeah. There's one video, one video that I didn't write. I changed bits and pieces, but basically it was written by Kurt Cobain, and that won all the awards. So maybe I have to rethink my writing, yeah.
Anyone else?
Okay, I think if there are no more questions, we make a little short break, and we have still the opportunity to sign some books, and then we start with the film.
Okay, well, thanks very much, and I hope you enjoy the film. Yeah.
Thank you for coming.
And thank you, Bart.
Yeah, man. Thank you very much. Yeah.